Good morning and welcome once again. I hope you had a great time in the past hours, and that session turned you back, if you are older than 28, turned you back to thinking about being 28 again. If you are not yet 28, you're looking forward to be 28 again. Now, this session is about visions and opportunity in startup, particularly in technology entrepreneurship. And we're very pleased to have Ms. Janet Wong, the Commissioner of Innovation and Technology of the Hong Kong government. Janet, please come up stage. And three speakers, Dr. Rosanna Wong, who is the Executive Director of Hong Kong Federations of Youth Group, and Mr. Nick Yan, the advisor to the Chief Executive on Innovation and Technology, and our alumni, Dr. Johnson Lau, the CEO and Chairman of Kinex Pharmaceutical. And from this point onward, the stage is Janet's and the speakers.
Hello? Can you hear me well? Okay. Good morning, and so happy to meet all of you here. I think we all come for a purpose, that is to turn our dreams to reality. And today I'm very happy to take part in your exploration process. And first of all, I would like to introduce our three speakers today. On my right-hand side is Rosanna. Hello. If you are a youth, you will definitely know Rosanna. So you must say you know her. Rosanna is the Executive Director of the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups, and she's an expert in training young people. And I have seen many of her very good projects, like the M21 platform, a digital platform. And Rosanna would definitely share with us her insight in the world of youth. Next, sitting next to Rosanna is Nick Yan. I think you also know Nick. Nick is the non-official member of the Executive Council, advisor to the Chief Executive of Innovation and Technology, and he's also my chairman of the Advisory Committee on Innovation and Technology. And before, Nick works as the Executive Vice President of the Hong Kong Polytechnic. Nick is also the CEO of Cyberport, and so and Nick also worked in venture capital companies, so you will tell us a lot about the entrepreneur world. And sitting furthest away is Johnson, Dr. Johnson Lau. Johnson is also a Hong Kong U alumni, and he specializes in viral hepatitis and liver cancer research, and has taught in both US and UK. And Johnson has a very good career in the biotech and biomedicine world, which is very important in the world of technology. He's now CEO and chairman of a pharmaceutical company. And so, Johnson, I expect to hear more from you on the more specialized area on the biotech side. So can I invite you all to give our speakers a round of applause, please? Thank you. Let us warm up first. I think we all agree that the area of startup is getting warmer, if not hot, in Hong Kong. I give you some figures to show this. According to Invest Hong Kong, the number of co-work or incubation locations has increased from only 3 in the year of 2010 to 35 in 2014. So this jump is really amazing. And in 2012, there was only 1 private sector incubator in Hong Kong. That is apart from Cyberport and Science Park, which are supported by government. But now, again, in 3 years' time, there are now 8. And I think this figure may be now still changing because there's always a lead time. And Ellen Yeung, science partner, my good colleague, gave me the figure that the amount of investment obtained by the incubators and graduates of Science Park has increased from 29 million in 2013/14 to some 200 million in 14/15. So in 1 year's time, it is seven times. So it seems good money lying around. And we must capture the opportunity. So the panel discussion will be divided into two parts. First of all, I will have a chit-chat with our speakers, and then I will open for the Q&A session. The first general question for all of you is, yeah, we know that it is coming, it is very robust, and how, as Hong Kong people, Hong Kong startups, based on our unique position geographically at the doorstep of China, economically, socially, everything, how can our young people seize the opportunity? And I would like to comment on the session just now that everybody feels it is easy to say, 我昨天辭了工了, I quit my job. But, you know, as Zhang Leung said, you just write a letter, it is easy. But I think as responsible people, before you write that letter or send it out by WhatsApp, you must have a due thinking process. So I would like to ask our speakers to just comment on this very general front. Rosanna?
Thank you, Jeanette. Hello, everybody. And I'm so pleased to have this opportunity to share with you some of my thinking concerning entrepreneurship. I mean, just to respond to what Jeanette said about this morning when Zhang Leung talked about quitting jobs. I'm a typical person, never quit jobs. I mean, I just stay in working with young people all my life. So my argument, you know, over whether it should quit job, I mean, it's not, even if you want to be an entrepreneur, of course, you need to change from being employed by somebody to start your own business. Then you need to quit job. But because I have a son, my son is also an entrepreneur. He always tells me three things, which I think is very important. One is that talking about entrepreneur, it's very important we must bear in mind entrepreneurial spirit is not only appeared on being an entrepreneur. Even if you're employed, you can still have entrepreneurial spirit. I mean, I never quit my job. When I was in my job all my life, I still have this entrepreneur spirit all the time in my mind. So I think it's not everybody should be an entrepreneur. I mean, this the reality is that a very small number of people choose to be an entrepreneur. Now, let me give you a figure. We have done a survey, you know, with TDC. Just 2011, 1,000 young people that they were interviewed, which is a random sample, though you can quote that example, only 3% of our young people aged between 18 to 29 choose to be an entrepreneur, only 3%. By 2015, it go up to 5%, so there is an increase of 2%. Now, this is good. I mean, that's why Jeanette used the word, it's warmer now. It's much better than before. But when the question asks, are you intended to be an entrepreneur? We go up from 4% to 10% just within 3 years. 4% to 10%. So you can see that add up together, there are 15% of young people between 18 and 28, you know, have that intention to be entrepreneur. So I agree that it's getting warmer. I still remember by 2005 when I just advocate that entrepreneur is a choice for young people. It's a choice. You do not need to choose it, but Hong Kong should provide that choice for young people. But at that time, I have to say, it's very cool. Very cool. Nobody seems to be interested in entrepreneurship. The coolest part, in my experience, is the government. The government show no interest into this one. You know the reason why? Because you are helping young people to get failed, is it? Because the failure rate is so high. I mean, I don't want to step into anything that you help young people to get failed. And therefore, it's very cool. even the private sector is not that warm now, but I'm very happy, I have to say. In the recent years, you can see the government is getting warmer, the private sector is getting warmer, and the advocacy that we're continuous doing see some of the result. And I need to congratulate Hong Kong University for organizing this Dream Catcher with so many young people coming around and talk about it. Even though this may not be your choice, but talking about it can be your choice one day. But the point I want to make is that not everybody should be an entrepreneur and can be an entrepreneur. But to build this entrepreneur spirit within you is very useful, no matter whether you are employed or whether you start your own business. And I think Hong Kong needs this kind of entrepreneurial spirit, you know, with every young people. And I think this will bring hope to Hong Kong.
Yes. We have an entrepreneur. Nick, you always told me you used to be a Chong Lou. He said he's a, because you were in IC, right? And you in Polytechnic, I also know that you have run this micro fund, which has been very successful. So you must have seen a lot of these startups. So what is your assessment?
I'm happy to be here. Okay, first of all, I got to get the standard protocol out of the way. Thank you, Hong Kong U, for sponsoring. I see, is that the Consul General of Israel there? Anyway, I've been in Hong Kong since I was 28. No, literally, that's true. Okay. And I have started 12 ventures. Okay, but I just wanted to tell everyone here that entrepreneurship is in Hong Kong's blood. And I want to give you some facts. If everybody remember in the 67 when we had the big riot, I understand a lot of you are probably younger than, too young to know about the big riot in 1967. But what happened after that is Hong Kong sort of re-emerged from that riot, became one of the four little dragons of Asia. You probably know that. This happened during the 70s and 80s. And at that time, Hong Kong also built the MTR, which today we know you can't imagine what Hong Kong would be like without MTR. Now, those were very, very so-called innovative moves. But I do want to point out that in the days when Hong Kong was the economic one of the four dragons of Asia, if you go to Kwun Tong area, there were over 4,000 factories there. And each one of them started out as an entrepreneur. Because prior to that, there was no factory, okay? So what happened in the early 80s or the mid-80s, the Pearl River Delta sucked away that entire manufacturing sector. I had a factory of 1,500 workers, I had to shut it down. Lay off 1,500 workers with my tears, pay them all the severance pay plus more. I didn't know what their future would be. But then again, Hong Kong re-emerged out of that. Okay, we became a service economy. Today, as you know, our strongholds are in financial services, trading and logistics, tourism, and also professional services. These four pillars constitute more than 51% of our GDP. But again, if you look at that, more than 90% are SMEs. So again, SME typically come from entrepreneurship, typically. So again, entrepreneurship is really in our blood. It is in our blood. Now what I see is we face another challenge in the future because the internet is changing the world, that we at Hong Kong, we have to change. We have to leverage on that, and then Johnson will add to that later with his vision in biotech. But then I believe Hong Kong entrepreneurs can rise again. And this is what I call the Hong Kong 3.0 wave, because we went through 1.0 to become the dragon, 2.0 to become the financial, the services center, and then now 3.0, we have to make change. So I pride myself to say I'm a Chong Lou because I actually involved myself in 1.0, 2.0, and soon, hopefully, I'll be involved in 3.0.
Yeah, Johnson?
First of all, let me share with you that it's great to see a big group here, and the former speakers, they were great in terms of motivation. But I want to alert people with regard to sound bites is different from the actual reality. The difference between picking the sound bites and picking the process in between how to get it done. Now, to declare for your information, I was a faculty in the University of Hong Kong after my graduation from medical school. And actually, I did quit when I was 27. But I didn't quit to be entrepreneurial. I quit with regard to trying to learn the domain knowledge to get myself ready for the next stage. Now, three things I want to clarify for the former speakers are, number one, I don't think that they mean to ask every one of you to quit. Otherwise, there will be social instability. And also that the unemployment rate will be too high. They are just saying that there are certain characteristics for people who are successful. And usually, when they see it early, they see correctly, which they also emphasize. But I want you to pick the sound bite. You need to see correctly. Then you quit. Now, remember the statistics. 0.6% are successful. When there's 1,000 people here, that means 6 of you will be successful. And if you count Rosanna, Nick Yeung, or even count myself, then you are 3 gone already. That means chances actually. Now, number two is that if you want to see opportunity, don't follow the herd. When everybody is talking about China, think carefully. When everybody thinks about internet, think very carefully. It's very easy to think. Let me give you some statistics. When people talk about statistics, when there's a good opportunity to have a Tang Sun, say for example, which Pony Mai and myself are very good friends. In fact, he is my second largest shareholder. So you can see that I know Pony really well. And I can tell you that instead of, I want to follow the king is actually my boss, second boss. Then think of it this way. If there's a good opportunity on internet and there's no barrier to entry, and 100,000 people can do that, your chance of success is like 0.01%. Even if you are much better than most people by 100 times, your chance of success is only 1%. But if you pick something that is having a higher barrier to entry, like biotech, say for example there's a project, only 10 people can do it, your chance of success is already 10%. If you're better than 9 of these people, your chance of success is virtually 100%. So why to pick those with less than 1% chance of success instead of picking something that has a much higher chance of success? That's part number two. So the soundbite, be very careful. So when people talk about China, I'll talk about Hong Kong. Hong Kong has a lot of advantage. Instead of thinking just, okay, China has all this, why not think about Hong Kong? I can tell you, I went to China. When you go to China, they consider you to be great. You are Chinese, but you're still not a mainland China Chinese. I can tell you, when I go to Taiwan, they told me that you're great, but you're still not a Taiwan Chinese. Hong Kong, they welcome you because you're Hong Kong Chinese. So there's some advantage over there. The third thing to remember is that when you see something, there's a difference between dream catchers. I like Paul actually used a very good name called dream catchers. Dream catchers is to catch your dream. There's a difference between dream catchers and you want to be the boss. A lot of people equated that, it's an equation, that I want to be the boss, I want to be very rich, and therefore they think it's a dream catcher. No, a dream can be a project. I want to see this successful. And that's called a dream catcher. May not necessarily equal to the fact that you want to be a boss. Now, if you fulfill all this, and I think the former speaker did a very good job in terms of the quality of the person. And the four of us are discussing about quality because I gave a talk recently with the invitation of Dr. Manson Fogg on called the humanity, hope, humanity, and biotechnology. And I define that for people who are successful, if you look at them, there are three levels of quality. The fundamentals, the driver, and also the quality for it to be successful. The fundamentals are two. Number one is called faith. You have to faith that humanity is important. Hong Kong is going to be good. Love, because if you only love yourself, there's no chance that you'll be too successful. You need to love humanity, you need to love other people. The second level is hope. Hope is the best driver. You hope for the better, for yourself, for other people, and they will drive you to nuts. And that's called what we call driving to be hungry, to be successful, because you have hope for better humanity, better faith, better love. And finally, you have the personality. You can't be, I want to be the nice guy and I want to be the CEO. You can't, it go opposite. You cannot be a nice guy and be a CEO. You need to have the resolve. Pound the table, pound it to be successful, as well as the ability to share. If you cannot share, you cannot be too successful. So when people see the success of Google, what they don't know is Sergey actually make the best decision when he hired employee number 5. who is called Eric. He was the CEO. He drove the company to success based on the idea. But if you're not willing to share, you cannot be too successful. Jerry Yang actually hired the CEO when Yahoo started to kick off. Now, therefore, if you see dream catchers as equal to I want to be the boss and I want to be in total control, which is actually weak point of Chinese, then I can tell you the chance of success is not very too high. Now, if you pick the right sound bites and then couple together, Hong Kong has a very good opportunity for you. I've been trying to help Hong Kong to promote bar technology. I can share with you, just in the last 2 years or so, we start 10 companies in Hong Kong in biotechnology. So I want to encourage all the youngsters that if you're interested in starting up, especially in the difficult to start like biotechnology, Hong Kong is a very good place to do.
Yeah, so Johnson's point is you calculate the percentages, how many people, and you have to look around the people like yourselves and hands on heart. Are you sure you are better than the vast majority of most of them? I think I always tell the kids, maturity is that you will not speak humble, too humble, 妄自菲薄, but neither should you, you know, be full of yourself that you're better than everybody. Because of Paul Jung's brief to me, we are going to discuss technopreneurship. So I would like to move on to the practical process of operating or running a startup and seek the advice of our speakers. First of all, I divide the process roughly into four stages, okay? The first is the verification of an idea, all right? Everybody said, I have a bright idea. Hang on, you say it is bright. Is it really very bright? By what standard it is bright? Or it is actually, in most people's eyes, it is a me too idea, all right? And get a boo if you spend all your money on it, then it will be horrible. The second stage is, of course, lip service is no use, okay? How to get into action, and action needs money. So how to raise funds, and other than the three Fs, friends, fools, and family, which won't sustain, you know, how do we actually attract the eyeballs of the investors? So that is the second stage. The third stage will be, all right, you are good. Somebody give you money, okay? But I have seen many startups, they don't have a chance to fail because of technology. They haven't come to that stage. They fail because they burn their cash in a reckless manner, and everything is finished before, you know, he was thinking clearly. So how to sustain the startup, and from there to grow the startup? And the last one, regrettably, 99% may not have IPO or money. So the exit decision. Just now in the Q&A session, a person asked, you know, where is the balance, all right? From our young days, we teach our kids, 自古成功在上市, 是吗? So we say that you do it again. You haven't done it hard enough. 我们年轻人说很扯, 是吗? But when do you stop 再扯呢? Because insistence, persistence could get to be obstinate or stubborn. And so when is the time to 壮士断臂 and fail big, fail quickly, and move to the second, to move to a new phase in life? And Rosanna, I would particularly like to talk about 心理質素, because startups, okay, some people are fortunate, you have got rich families or friends, but some the money are raised. I have seen cases where he bets not only his money, but actually his 人生. You know, he raises money from all the wife's relatives, you know, and if it fails one day, it's not just a business fail, but it is facing the whole world, you have been very familiar with. So, 心理質素很重要. So, which of you would like to start?
Maybe, thank you, Jeanette. I think I want to make reference to what I have done for young people, started from 2005, when I started the Youth Business Hong Kong at that time, when the period is very cool, up to what we are now a bit warmer. Now, from my experience, I I see that young people's concern, what are some of the concerns? Because I meet up, I have a lot of opportunity to talk to young entrepreneurs, their problems, you know, their wishes, you know, how they want to see. So I just summarize, you know, what I heard, you know, from some of the young people in response to your, you know, about their psychology. You see, the statistic shows that more male than female, you know, enter into startup business. But now it will change, probably more women now. I mean, I never know. But so far, our statistics show more male, a little bit more male than female. And then about 50% of those startup, you know, in my, you know, encounters are university graduates. So that means there are 50% who do not have university education, but they want to start business. So we're talking about actually two different populations. One is more educated startup. One is less educated startup. So it's very important that we give equal opportunities to these people too. You know, the concern they come to me are very much similar. There are three things they always come to me. One, they want money. They want startup seed money. So my program, you know, started to give them $100,000 only. Now we raise up to $150,000. But there's so many applications. And I can only pick up so far for 10 years, is only 160 applications that I dish out. So that means the demand is about 2,000 applications. So you can see the market is huge. First concern is that they need money, so that's why they come to me. Second thing they need is mentoring, support, particularly how to start a business, how to stop a business, how to do a cash flow, how to do a balance sheet, and all these stuff. So mentoring is second. And thirdly, is an opportunity to share, a platform to share. Now, in order of priority, the three areas of challenges young people need, they seem to want more opportunity for mentoring over cash. They want support. They want practical advice, you know, from people who have started up their business. Not totally for all success stories. They don't want success story. Pony Ma people, all these, yes, they want to hear, but they want failure stories. They need what they want to learn from failures. Why is it that fails? Why is it like this? And therefore, a lot of them learn more from failures than learn from success. And then on sharing, I have to say, now I actually started up a, you know, a general chamber of entrepreneurs now, young entrepreneur. You know, the purpose, I started up this general chamber of young entrepreneurs, is to provide an opportunity for young people to share. And this sharing, just like Rotary Club, just like, you know, 总商会, and just like other, it's very important to let young people share and cross over. And this kind of sharing is not in Hong Kong, but in Shenzhen, in Guangzhou, in Shanghai, and everywhere around the world. This platform is extremely important. So I think if we're able to provide to young people the three areas, and I'm sure, you know, they will feel more comfortable and more secure when they start their business. And they need to be prepared that one day they will fail, but at least the community that we create for them will give them a lot of support. And I think this is the way forward that we'll continue to do it. Nick?
Yes. I like to give you through actual examples. People been talking to me that they have problem raising money. So what I did is I say, okay, I'll help you. Why don't you give me your business plan? Let me look at it. I'll sign a non-disclosure agreement. And then I'll give my comment. And once I read it, and I read hundreds of them, by the way, and they all seem to fall into a certain pattern. I'll give you one of the pattern. I asked them, after I read it, I say, what do you think the investor, when they invest $1 in your venture, how much money they're looking to make in the next 5 years? And inevitably, the entrepreneur come back and say, $10. I say, no, it's $100 or more. So I say, the problem with your business plan is you gotta convince your investor that he's gonna make $100 or more. Okay, so that you can convince them to get the money. Whether you're going to reach that is another thing, but you got to be able to sell that way. So again, but in order to sell that you can make $100, you got to prove that your business is scalable, the market is there, you know the technology evolution, da la da la, all that. So immediately you got to open your eyes wider. So that's number one. And then the second thing I observe is I say, I have a problem with your shareholder structure. Why? Because like yima gu their friends and all that. So all your shareholder, I say that is not very good, because if your shareholder structure is not new investor friendly, they are not going to invest in your company. And you cannot reorganize every time you go and raise the money. You can't do that. So this is something that you need to look at your shareholder structure very carefully. Okay? And in fact, 80% of the people who gave me business plan, they don't have a sound and robust shareholders agreement. So that means if you have your girlfriend as a shareholder, you cannot kick her out, you know, at the right time. Or a boyfriend, doesn't really matter, okay? So this is one of the problems you have to face. So these are the two typical things I like to share. Then it comes, the fact is, when do you exit? Now that's a very good question. I always tell people is, you need to have KPIs in your business plan. And when you don't meet the KPI, you better ask yourself one question. Am I still on the right track? Okay? Chances are, if you set your KPI right, things are not going your way. You're going to have to get out. And one of the most strange and so-called unthinkable exit is, I've told people, is I say, know your competition. Okay? Because oftentimes, one of the best exits that an entrepreneur will make, eventually, didn't look successful at the front, but eventually what may lead to success, is consider a merger with your competitor. Okay? Because when you're each one, you're very weak, but 1 + 1 = 2.5, you're gonna survive. This is something that a lot of entrepreneurs don't see. Okay? So those are some of the micro advice I can give you.
Nick, may I have a follow-up? You said that when you have a business plan, you say, I give you $1. How many will you give me back? Okay, 10, 100. Okay. Usually, how much water is there? You know, 水分, you know, you say, you allege, 廣東話話俾個皇帝你做啦，咁我話你信唔信先？ How do you convince the investor that you mean and you can deliver? Is it never overstate, okay, or what?
Okay, I started 12 business, okay, and I was a VC, I look at business plan. Typically, I look at about 1,000 business plans a year. Maybe consider 10, and eventually maybe invest in 2. Okay, that's the kind of ratio. And out of that 2, probably a third of them will become successful. But that's kind of odds, VC phase. So what a typical VC looks for is, do you really understand the business? The business definition has to be very clear. Most people are going to business saying, oh, there's an opportunity, it's a given. But you really have to know the business, okay? Whether or not your business will be disrupted by other technology, you gotta realize that, because most of the entrepreneurs don't know business definition very well. And the second thing is, when they put down numbers, now, most number is like a projection like this, okay, nobody knows. But if it's a good entrepreneur, okay, they already know what the modus operandi is all about, and they know how much hardship they're gonna go through, and they will put down some realistic numbers. So you can actually separate out what salary, what are the expenses, and how much you're gonna spend in marketing, you know, rather than those pro forma stuff, because the VC will ask that. And a lot of time they will ask you, what if there's not enough money? What would you do? Okay? So you can't just say, we're going to raise another round of money. That's not the answer. Okay?
Johnson, fundraising especially.
Actually, there's a lot of money around. I have never had problems raising money. I'll show you how should we do the tricks and how to do it. But first of all, I would like to, again, give you the right sound bite. Failure, even though I gave a talk before called Failure to Success, I would encourage you to understand that according to them, I don't have that many failures. And therefore, according to them, I'm a total failure because I don't have that many failures. And the reason behind being that you do not need to make the mistakes yourself. What you need to do is, before you do anything, look at other people. What mistakes the other people make? I used to tell my trainees is that if you make mistakes by yourself, it's important for you to learn what you have learned. But why don't you just look at the people around of similar, doing similar things? What mistakes have they made? If you learn from your own mistakes, you're a great guy. If you can learn from others' mistakes before you actually make a mistake, that's even better. So the way I encourage people is that look at other people's mistakes and tell me what you have learned and how to prevent this from happening in the first place. That would be the first message I want to share with a lot of people. Number two, to answer all Janet's questions, I only have one answer, one word. Find the right mentor. 找个好师傅。 And there are good mentors around. Find a good mentor. I have a lot of mentors in my career, in my life. If you find a right mentor, you actually avoid a lot of problems. A lot of problems. And number three, I want to again echo Nick's comment with regard to all this other business plan. I have a very good example here, Kevin. Through Paul Jones' initiative, training some of the faculties to be entrepreneurial. So I participate in helping Kevin's program. He learned, right, that you need to know how to do an operating agreement, how to make sure you are not in control, balance of control, how to create a board, how to make sure you have a performer P&L, and I have to teach him how to spell the word performer, right? Which means lying, by the way. and how to calculate, and how to make sure that nobody's in control so that everybody feels comfortable, and making sure there's no wife or husband to be in the shelter. Now, what it means is that Hong Kong actually has a lot of success people. In fact, you'll be amazed to know that Hong Kong has infrastructure. I encourage Nick and I encourage Janet all the time, and Rosanna probably can participate, with regard to having a mentorship program. Now, I actually sit in one of the very successful meetings arranged by Terence Lau and Nick. I sat in Poly U for one whole day, listening to 10 professors' presentation. I only found one that's worth investing. And then finally, I found the second one to invest. But the other eight, how would they react? If they react with regard to, oh, I hate Johnson, that means they will never be a very successful entrepreneur. What they have to do is that they will sit down and think, okay, what did I learn? How can I make myself better? In fact, those are very, very good programs to encourage people to go to the next level of success. Now, how to raise money is, again, not difficult. I never told people that you can make 100 times money. In fact, if you say it this way, people will not trust you. You have to give the real number. The real number is the number that people believe you. In fact, I got, you may want to know that 2 years ago, I was taking over a company that was 100% owned by the US investors. I want to make this into Hong Kong success. In less than 2 years, actually, I raised more than $1 billion Hong Kong dollars here. $1 billion Hong Kong dollars. With around only 12 investors. Pong Li Ma is among one of them. And he is so respectful to another major investor who is so quiet that he is actually the number two shareholder. He's not even the number one. And Anthony Nam Fong is among another one of the top 10. What I want to share with you is that if you cannot raise money, instead of blaming other people, there is money around, ask yourself internally, is there anything that I need to improve before I can attract people to invest? Now, I also want to share with you that ITC is actually great. I can tell you ITC is great. I mean, I have been working very closely, even though there are all this potential negative energy here and there, but there's always a way to sort things out, and the key is that if you're not prepared for people to say no to you, then don't even try. I can tell you for Google, Sergey told me 98% of the investors he talked to did not invest in Google, but he has the list. So one of these days he's going to name the 98 investors who did not invest. So there are different ways to handle it, but there is resources around, and ask yourself first before you actually talk about the system.
Mm. Okay, now we thanks for all the very inciting comments. I would now like to go to the Q&A session, but before that, I have a surprise attack on our speakers, which I didn't think about it until just recently. Before the end of the session, may I invite each speaker to say 1 minute about the three characteristics of failed people. You know, I don't want to talk about success formulas. I've just seen too many. But you know, you have all yu yan mo so la. Okay, can you just give me three adjectives of a typical failed subject? Whether he's stubborn, he doesn't listen to others, or what. Okay, we'll come round, and I would encourage all of you to write down the three qualities of a typical failed subject and match with the nine adjectives, they may duplicate, okay? So let us have a list of failure qualities. As Johnson say, you know, we don't need to really be burnt and be treated to know that fire is dangerous, okay? We should learn from other people's mistakes. Okay, so with that, may I open the Q&A? Is some colleague having a mic to be handed? Oh, just like the session. So people will come and, okay. So I'll open the floor. Anybody who is interested, please come forward. Okay? All right, and so the people can come forward. But before that, I'll give time for the people to come forward. I would just like to ask the speakers, if I have a piece of white paper and I'm allowed to work in Hong Kong, in China, and in the rest of the world, where should be the best bet generally? Of course, circumstances of the person is very important. But, but how would you analyze? Because I went to this talk by Jack Ma. I think he gave me a very insightful answer. He said that in Putonghua is 香港人觉得中国很困难, 那么中国很困难, 去印度困不困难, 去美国困不困难, 如果你觉得困难, 那么你就留在香港, okay? So in English is, you feel China may be difficult, but is India difficult? Is USA difficult? Is it because difficult, you won't do something? Then you stay in Hong Kong, but is Hong Kong really not difficult either? Okay, so I think he has a point, but you know, from your perspective, geographical analysis.
Can I start? I've never, thought of this geographical considerations, because if you're an entrepreneur, no matter where you go, you're an entrepreneur too. But one thing I admit, Hong Kong is very expensive to start business. Particularly, I mean, of course now because of this internet evolution, you can see that, to make a startup more affordable than before. But otherwise, Hong Kong is expensive. You know, what I can only say, because of time, I think try Chin Hai. I declare interest on this one too, because Chin Hai has a new opportunities now, which is very close to Hong Kong. And then from the central to Chin Hai is about within an hour or 45 minutes. And there is a dream hub. There is an entrepreneur hub, just set up for Hong Kong, for China, as well as for the world. It's a combination of three altogether in Chin Hai. And just now Nick talked about, business being scalable. And I think that Chin Hai will be an opportunity for Hong Kong, entrepreneur who want to scale up the business in China and learn about China. And I think the opportunity, it's a good one. And if you want to explore more about the opportunity in Chin Hai, I think it's something that you should consider. Otherwise, everywhere, to me, it's the same.
Think global. Don't even think local. If you think local, don't be entrepreneurial. That would be my advice, number one. Number two, Chin Hai is good because Pony Ma told me the same thing. And number three is that for those people who only dream of, I set up a new website and I want to make tons of money, think twice. Because I can share with you that I learned from Manson that he went to Chongqing. Chongqing already declared that no more support for IT company. Because there's just too many people thinking that another IT company, you'll be successful. When people are so ahead of you, how can you beat people? If you want to be entrepreneurial, you need to think different. Everybody in one direction, don't go in that direction. Go in some other direction. That has a much better chance than go into the same direction. And then find the right mentor and the right people, talk, and then that will be the best way to be successful. But my advice is think global. If you ask me which is the best business environment, I actually think Hong Kong is actually very good, actually. Think Hong Kong very good. Despite the fact that, I can leak the information that I just got more than subject support from the US government. I still can tell you that Hong Kong is actually very good. It all depends on how you work the system. If you work the system correctly, think global, communicate, and then also Hong Kong is actually very, very good. Hong Kong is extremely good with regard to being a superhighway between China and US. And therefore, instead of thinking about China, think about Hong Kong as a superhighway. I myself, if I'm going to have another extra minute, would like to devote every single minute I have to create Hong Kong as a superhighway between China, US, and Europe.
In order not to delay the questions, my answer is very simple, okay? It's, if you want to look at China, Shenzhen. It's right next door. They talk our language. We made them great over the past decades. I think they will come back, work with us, make us great too. So the best thing is Hong Kong plus Shenzhen. That's my opinion.
Okay, thank you. So we come to the questions. Yes?
I think that gentleman was first.
Oh, I see. That gentleman. Please start. And can you also identify yourself so, you know, we know your background?
I'm Aloysius. I'm doing my PhD in School of Biological Sciences. I work on lipid metabolism and obesity. So when I talk to people about having a startup in an industry which is not my area of expertise, I get, most of the time I get a negative answer because they always advise me to stay with my expertise. And the issue I see here is today you don't really need to enroll in a course in a university to know to gain the knowledge for any field. So we have MOOCs, we have a lot of online courses which we can take, and we get like similar knowledge. And like one scenario I see in terms of young people, they tend to go to the service industry. I wouldn't say IT, a service industry, because when they fail, they see there is the financial implications are much lesser when I go into like biotech itself, or when I go to industries which are very costly, being a fresh graduate and not having too many networks. Yeah, like what will be your advice on like jumping fields and like the financial implication? So if I have a startup in a service industry, where I fail, I learn something, I make some money, then I go to biotech, where I have money to invest, my own money, and then maybe I can grow further.
Yeah, perhaps we listen to the questions first, so the gentleman can sit down. Professor, yes?
Thank you. I'm Ken Cheng. I'm an orthopedic surgeon from the University of Hong Kong. I'd like to follow up on the point on fundraising. I mean, Dr. Lau said he has no problem with fundraising. But I think if we listen to him, I think he is probably genetically born to be a fundraiser. For many of us, we don't know how to ask for money. So I'd like to hear from the panel, really. I mean, what are the qualities that we should try to develop if we don't have those particular genes that makes us natural?
Thank you, Professor. Yes, hello, Peter.
Hi, my name is Peter Liu. To my friends and associates, they call me a headhunter. To me, I call myself a dream maker. I help people make their dreams come true. Now, the biggest challenge I face on a daily basis, because I interview on average about 4 or sometimes 5 executives a day, most of them are in their 40s or 50s. The biggest thing is, I told them I'm a dream maker, but most of them don't know what their dreams are. Now, with all of you sitting up on stage, because they react every day, they're very good at what they do, but when it comes to the next phase of the career, what kind of a legacy would they like to leave behind before they retire? Because as I mentioned, most of them are in their late 40s or even 50s. So what advice should you give to these people? So you can share with me, so next time when I encounter similar situations, I can give them advice as well. Thank you.
Thank you. We have three questions. So it's jumping field, fundraising, and also Peter, dream, you know, or how to make this dream come true. So open to the speakers, free to comment.
Can I just start the three comments about jumping fields? You know, I have a lot of young people come to me saying that I don't like my job. I want to quit. And I want to do some good for the community. I mean, young people nowadays, you know, very different from our days, they always want to do good for the society, which is very good in my view. But when you jump from your professional to doing something good, sometimes they don't know how to do good things because they only know how to make money, for example, in their own field. But when you do good things, you need a different approach. You need a non-profit mentality. You need, you know, something that probably less efficient than what you're doing. Now, this kind of things that always happen among young people now. Social enterprise has become very popular, but a lot of them failed. So I think, in order to, you know, because of time, I can't do more talking on this one, but I have a lot of experience seeing how young people fail in social enterprises. It's because of jumping field without knowing what exactly this field is. So I think you must be able to prepare and know what you would. You may probably learn a lot of the, you know, the things you have learned from your own practices and then, you know, bring it over to the social enterprise. But this is too simplistic. And therefore, you must know what you want. If you don't think that doing good is something that you have already have all the qualities with you, you have to learn this field very well. And one thing about dream. And I think you are absolutely right. Hong Kong young people are not dream makers all the time. I always want to share with you, because I pay a lot of attention on some of the indexes. And I think this index can always use as a reference. Now look at the recent index about the Digital Evolution Index. Hong Kong did very well as a standout economy. That means digital penetration is extremely well in Hong Kong. If you look at the Global Competitiveness Index, Hong Kong did very well too. But if you look at the Bloomberg Innovation Index, Hong Kong did very poor. I do not believe a vision of dream or a vision of entrepreneurship without an infrastructure of creativity and innovation. I think we are far behind. When Bloomberg look into innovation, he looked into a lot of factors: research, higher education, secondary education, patents, high tech companies. So it's very revealing. I think Hong Kong needs a culture, a new culture that inspired not only creativity, innovation, but entrepreneurship.
I think I want to get more questions. I'll answer very simply. I guess none of you met Steve Jobs. I had the pleasure of meeting him several times. So if he's still alive today, we'll be the same age. Let me just tell you what Steve taught me. He said, the success today is not about individual excellence. It's about how you create collective excellence. Now, if you look at how Steve Jobs succeed, his iPhone is not individual creativity. It's actually pulling together a whole bunch of stuff that's already existed and then made it happen, okay? So think about that. And you will leverage on your past knowledge only if it will help you to get further. But unfortunately, we live in a world, a very disruptive world, so we will have to change. So one of the way you inspire people, and this goes to Peter's question, is you gotta tell people is why do you have to have a dream? Because there's a need to change, okay? I mean, whether or not you want to change or not, the world is changing around you, so you have to change. The fact while you're changing, you gotta have hope. Johnson's word, hope. The combination of change, hope, change and hope, is what dreaming is all about, of creating a dream. So I'll leave it as vague as that. And the third thing about funding, I think one of the people, again, you know, I cannot comment on Johnson who goes and raises a $1 billion Hong Kong, but most people, when you raise your first seed fund or small fund, what you really know is you need to have connection and you need to have practice. Now, those two things, okay? So connection is getting a good mentor and all that help, but I want to talk about practice. Today, the co-working spaces, they have these jam and pitch session. Go to them, because the pitch session are probably your best opportunity to see how people sell their idea, and you need to have that skill, okay? So that's a necessary skill that you gotta have to have in order to raise money. You gotta convince people that your idea is good so they're willing to put money into you. Okay, so those are the short answers.
Yes. Three questions, okay. The question on from the headhunter, simple. Find them the right boss. Find a boss that like people to be dynamic. All my companies, I told them our business plan is very simple. Our business plan is we keep on changing. So find them the right boss. The question from McCann with regard to where to find money, again, very simple. If it's textile, find Nam Fong. If it's social media, find Rosanna. If it's IT, find Nick. If it's biotech, find myself. And if you cannot locate me, find Stephen Yeung and also Ben Tang over there. They will take a look. We have actually a fund to support something like that to happen. So go and look for them. They are money around, just look for them. Now, if they don't like your idea, then ask yourself, there is money around. Ask yourself that maybe your business plan has a problem. With regard to the first question, whether you should jump, don't. Because there's always a way to do dot connections between different disciplines. Why, you ask the question, why is Pong Li so interested to work with us? Because he also sees that the next step for IT will be to connect with healthcare. The next step of IT connect with which discipline? Think. If you think that your discipline can fit into IT, fit into IT. If you cannot fit into something else, with regard to community delivery, even logistics. I can tell you there's a major problem of logistics in China with regard to pharmaceutical delivery. And I can tell you already, I don't have time to handle that. That is a much easier way to be successful because there is a need for that. There's a client for that. And finally, when there's an issue, I want to echo everybody, find a team. Because a lot of times is that people want to be the boss, they want to be in charge. No. Work with a team of people. Recently, I sort of worked with a lot of people with regard to breaking the Santao Ji. Okay? And one of the problem of PhD, and I'm a professor, I can tell you, professors are not the best person to collaborate with. They're difficult. Why? Because when I was a professor, I read a grant, you have to say that my lab, my research result, everything is mine. But in business, it's all about we, our. So there's a major break point with regard to that. And I can tell you the good part is ITC know about it. Because when you have your panel, all these professors, I mean, they're difficult. I told Nam Fong, I said, if you want to find a professor to evaluate my business plan, don't even try. I withdraw. I don't want to talk to you. Okay? So it's important. I can tell you the best people to create team engineers. They are the best. Why is China so successful recently? Look at all the Chinese government's leadership. They use engineers, they build bridges together. They build buildings together, they build everything together. Who will be the worst in terms of team players? Doctors, myself, medical doctors. Because when you walk into the operating room, you're in charge, right? You're so used to be running the show, right? You don't allow other people, you do not accept other people's idea. People have to tune and adjust. And in relation to that, there are people who are very good. I mean, I can give you one of the best virologists in the whole world is Yun Go Yong Gao Sao, KY Yun. He wanted to do something, he talked to Professor Manson Fogg and myself, we tried to help him. We know Hong Kong government do not have the infrastructure to help, we know that. We still go through the process, then we got the idea with regard to getting donations. I can tell you, with 10 phone calls, we raised 1,500,000 Gongji, with regard to starting process of pushing to help Hong Kong to have a rapid response system to deal with a Lao Gam. So the bottom line is that there are lots of people in Hong Kong who are willing to help. Let me ask you the question. Will you believe, if this has not happened, that with this particular donation, I actually got donation from University of Hong Kong? Usually people donate money to University of Hong Kong or Poly U. This time, we have Poly U and University of Hong Kong donating money to the foundation to make it happen. There are lots of good people around, lots of money around. The key is to make sure people understand that this is for the good of people. People feel this way, and then things will happen. And my encouragement to people is that follow your heart, but at the same time, make sure that what is the motive behind. If it's good, people will follow.
Johnson, I think ITC has found very good professors. We have professors with technopreneurship mind, so you don't need to worry.
And you did not recruit me, so I'm a bad one.
And my reaction, because they know more about the private sector. The ITC runs the Innovation Technology Fund, and basically it's the government venture capital fund. If you ask me, my experience is that I will through a process of reading the application and interviewing the person. Actually, I sometimes do it very relaxingly, but I look for two things. He actually really understands what he's selling in terms of breadth and depth. So I don't understand the proposal sometimes, but I just keep on asking. And I look for inconsistencies, comparison, and see and then I will also go for breath. He will then say something about what is happening in America and or in other parts of the world. Fortunately, I don't understand, but my team, Cecilia, I have so many PhDs, so I can immediately verify the things that he's talking about, and I will keep on drilling him. Now with the internet, I have all the information, all my colleagues will keep on asking questions. So I think within 1.5 hours, if you do a training with your mentor, okay, I've been mentoring kids around, I always say, okay, let us have your iPhone ready and video our conversation in the 1 hour. Focus yourself. And you see it again. What did you see afterwards? A very complacent person that you tell everybody that you are better than anybody, or you don't look confident, or when I ask questions, on the breath, you look increasingly suspicious or try to be evasive. Then actually, at the end of the process, I think if that person is a clever person, he will know whether he fails or he succeeds. But if after 1.5 hours, there is no one point, that person fails to make me feel that he really understands and he means what he's speaking, then I think it will be a very good application. So next round of questions, yeah, on this side first, and then lastly, the lady. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. My name is Kai. Currently, I just graduated last year, and I currently work at McKinsey in New York. My team and I are working on a startup on the side, and eventually I want to move back to China. So my question is twofold. One, does it make sense for me if I want to move back to do it with the startup in terms of expanding it to China? Or does it make sense for me to perhaps move back and work in the country for a couple of years just so I can get a little bit more understanding of how the market is? And then secondly, if I were to kind of expand it, the startup to China, what are the best ways for me to find the right partners? Because as I've been talking to a lot of people, I found that finding the right partner, a trustworthy partner, is not as easy as it might be in some other parts of the world.
Okay, partners. Yes?
I'm not talking, sorry. Hi, everyone. I'm Esther, and I'm a student in Hong Kong U, and I have been participating a lot in YFG when I was in high school. And so my question is, I would like to ask two questions. The first one is, do you all think that entrepreneurship is actually a trend in Hong Kong right now, especially to the youth? And the second thing is, do you think entrepreneurship, like, what is the definition to you for entrepreneurship in Hong Kong? Because why would I ask that is because actually entrepreneurship, this word comes to me like a few months ago. So that's why I have been participating a lot and listen a lot to entrepreneurship. And then I heard that people were saying that, okay, if you want to do entrepreneurship, then find a problem to solve. Okay, then I started to find a problem to solve. Okay, and then I find that the problem that I want to solve, I don't think that is something that the VC wants to do it, because something that I want to do is not actually as a scale to be become an IPO or anything. And then a certain definition in Hong Kong, if I don't if I want to start my business, and then I should go to competitions, and I should find mentors, and I have to find VCs, and then, okay, if I find VC, it will be in a skill that I cannot control because of my age, and I do not have any experiences, and I believe that so many people, when they have the problem solved, they just find it, but they don't really understand the problem. So that's why I think that, okay, to trend, I don't know in other places, so in Hong Kong, that's the trend. Okay, you want to do business, find VC, and then get to a bigger scale, and then people do not think of sustainability. So that is my problem when I encounter when I think of entrepreneurship. So that's how I would like to ask for the
definition. All right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yes?
Thanks for giving me the chance for last question. So my question is, because some of my friends asking me where should they start their company? Is it in Hong Kong, or is it in Shenzhen, or somewhere else? Because they mentioned to me, although Hong Kong has a lot of advantages, for example, it's where East meet the West, and also it's a very open society, but at the same time, it has a lot of disadvantage, for example, risk tolerance, and also as Ms. Rosanna pointed out, Hong Kong lack the culture of entrepreneurship. So in that perspective, what do you think, like Hong Kong's advantage and disadvantage?
Okay, it's geographical again. Perhaps we, because of the limit of time, we will answer in a brief manner. Ladies first, Rosanna.
As I said, I mean, just answer the third question. I think Hong Kong, everywhere you do your business, there are pros and cons. I mean, I totally agree with what Johnson said. I mean, you need to think global. One day, even if you start your business now in Hong Kong, you can scale up in China and become global at the end of the day. So I don't think you should be too restrictive, you know, into the geographical, rather than you think what exactly your business are. Whether your business really had that value for you to scale up. I think it's the business that counts. It's not the geographic that counts. I mean, this is only my, because I'm not a start-upper myself, but this is how, you know, when I talk to young people, those who get successful are those thinking very global, which I totally agree.
Yeah, Nick?
Okay, the gentleman who's working for McKinsey, you're still working for McKinsey, right? Okay, I used to work for Bain, okay, so. So that means you come from a very good business school. But anyway, the idea is I don't think consulting firm is a good way to honing your entrepreneurial skills. So, but it's a good way to expand your business horizon, so to understand problems. So I would suggest don't spend more than 2 to 3 years there in McKinsey, even though it may be the
again, asking people to quit.
Let me qualify that. No, if you want to become entrepreneurs, don't stay more than 2 to 3 years, because otherwise you'll become too comfortable. Okay. So that's that will be my answer, because I was at Bain too. I got out in 2 years, but that doesn't mean quitting the job. You just move on. Okay. The next question is has to do how do you define engineers in Hong Kong? I find it very difficult to find a universal definition. I think entrepreneur just means you want to do something that is different or on your own. You want to take the risk, embrace the risk, okay? So oftentimes you find that if you take an idea that's contrarian, it's going to be very difficult to sell. But then again, I encourage you go to the pitch session, because there's a lot of contrarian ideas being sold there. So you'll learn honing the skill being sold. Mm-hmm. But I think Rosanna's answer on the location, totally agree with her. I think Johnson probably would agree too.
Three questions. McKinsey, I agree with him. It's a good starting point only, but you have very good pedigree and also connections, user connections. That will be the answer to your question. Second question, that girl about entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is very simple. You have a dream, be successful, not necessarily to be your company. It can be your idea being executed in the context of another company under the next umbrella. And if it's a biotech dream, because of your, I like you because you're aggressive, talk to me. I will enjoy having somebody like that to pursue a biotech project in one of our umbrella companies. With regard to the question of where, anywhere, just start a company. And if you want more specific advice, start a company in the locality that you have the most business. And if you want to have a good way to contain your tax consequence, which Janet will yell at me very soon, then start a Cayman Island company or a BVI company, and then with Hong Kong as a holding company. If you want to know how to do it, talk to Ben Tang. He's over there. He will teach you how to do it.
Okay, thank you. I think we had a very robust discussion, and I would like to invite Alan Yeung, our respondent. Alan will summarize. You have been observing us, I know. So what is your conclusion after our session? Over to you, Alan.
In 2013, Forbes magazine ranked Hong Kong the top tech city, technology city to watch after Silicon Valley and New York. At that time, many people cast a serious doubt whether Hong Kong can be that high. We heard from Jeanette, in the last 2 years, there's a lot of new startups, new co-working space, new private incubators, accelerators, and a lot more funding being raised. So today we actually heard from many good comments from the four speakers. So I'd like to summarize it here. From Rosanna, being an entrepreneur may not be right for everyone, but having an entrepreneurial mind should be for everybody. And Nick says that the entrepreneurship in Hong Kong actually is in everyone's blood, it's in our DNA. So he started from Hong Kong 1.0 and 2.0, and Hong Kong 3.0 is coming. And regarding the business plan, it's very important to know the business very well. Having a KPI for your business plan, and also know your competitors. It's likely that some point down the road, you can consider a merger and acquisition with your competitor and have a 1+1 bigger than 3. And from Johnson, don't follow the herd. Everybody is doing something doesn't mean it's right for you. Do something that you can have much higher chance of success, whether it's in internet or biotechnology or green technology. And learn from others' mistakes. It's the cheapest way to learn something. Of course, learn from your own. And find a good mentor is important. Think global is also another critical thing for everybody. So in the nutshell, whether Hong Kong can make it to the top tech city in the world, I think it's up to everybody here and up to the dream catchers of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you. So last of all, the three adjectives of stereotype failed personalities of company. Just from you, from your side first.
I don't like to talk about failures. I talk about success.
But we learn from other mistakes to avoid
success,
that is the cheapest way.
If you don't have it, then you think again, okay? There's a lot of success, three successful qualities. Number one, you need to think different. If you don't along the line of other people, then you don't have a very good chance. Think different. Number two, willing to share. And number three, have the guts to pound the table to make it happen.
Nick?
Very simple. First of all, people who don't know their failures. Second, people who don't learn from their failures.
Good.
Third, is people who don't know how to create collective excellence. That really is the failure, the character.
And they will repeat their failures in the end. Rosanna?
Those who usually fail are followers. They are not drivers. And secondly, they are very pessimistic, not optimistic enough. And certainly, they're not team players. A lot of failures are loners. So do not be loners. You must be optimistic, you must be a team player, you must be a driver.
Okay, so I hope your list will also let you avoid the mistakes in future. Thank you very much for your time, and I wish to see you one day walking up to one of us and telling us that you have caught your dreams. Thank you.